moderating the wonderful Joe Gawronski from Rosenblatt. Our panelists are Chairman Lee from the Dalian Commodity Exchange, Dennis O'Callaghan from CBOE, the exchange that invented, if you like, the management of the volatility. It's Veronica Augustsson, CEO of Cinnober, and finally, Alexander Afanasiev, who you all should recognize anyway from the video, but he is Chairman and CEO of the Moscow Exchange Group. Joe, thank you.
See if these are on. Great. Chairman Lee, do you want to get us started? Chairman Lee is going to read some prepared remarks, and then he's going to come back and join us for the rest of the panel.
Thank you, Nandini. Thank you, Joe. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very delighted to attend this meeting, and would like to introduce to you the recent development of the commodity futures market in China's mainland. Since taking shape in the early 1990s, the commodity futures market in China's mainland has achieved continuous rapid growth, improved the product structure, and increased the market size. Currently, there are four futures exchanges in China's mainland, one financial futures exchange, CFEX, and three commodity futures exchanges. Dalian Commodity Exchange, DCE, is one of them. A total of 46 commodity futures products have been launched, forming a product system of numerous industrial chains, including agriculture, energy and minerals, metals, as well as plastics and chemicals. From 2006 to 2015, commodity futures trading volume in China's mainland boasted an annual growth rate of 35%, much higher than that of the global futures and options in the same period, which was 8.5%. In 2015, commodity futures trading volume in China's mainland was more than 3.2 billion contracts, or 59% of the total of global commodity and options. In 2015, DCE traded over 1.1 billion commodity futures contracts, accounting for 34% of total commodity futures volume in China's mainland, or 20% of total global commodity futures and options volume, ranking number 8 among global derivatives exchanges. The average daily open interest of DCE in 2015 was 4.9 million contracts, or 45% of the total of commodity futures in China's mainland. In terms of the trading volume, DCE has become the largest futures market for iron ore, coking coal, coke, soybean meal, palm oil, and plastics, and the second largest futures market for agricultural commodities. Over the past 20 years, by learning from overseas experience, the commodity futures market in China's mainland has formed a set of development concepts and regulatory systems that are of Chinese characteristics and in line with the realities of the country, which have maintained the stable operations of the market. The Chinese government, regulators, and exchanges emphasize that the fundamental purpose of a commodity futures market is to serve the real economy. They have formulated rigorous standards and procedures for research, development, and launch of derivative instruments and products. Exchanges are mandated to consider the opinions from industrial firms, industry associations, and other related parties. DCE has been encouraging industrial firms to hedge in the futures market by hosting industrial conferences, organizing training activities, and reduce trading costs. Regulators and exchanges in China's mainland place a high priority on preventing and resolving systematic risks. Futures exchanges in China's mainland jointly established a national futures market monitoring center, which is in charge of margin monitoring and market surveillance. This effectively prevents illegal use of customer funds, as in the case of MF Global. All commodity futures exchanges in China's mainland implement a price limit on futures contract and have comprehensive risk management measures. These measures include margin adjustment, trading fee changes, and forced liquidation. For example, when contract price reaches the preset limit, exchanges can increase margins and price limit. The month before the delivery month, exchanges can lift margin levels in order to prevent massive delivery default. When there is a need to curb excessive trading, exchanges can increase trading fee according to relevant rules. Thanks to this regulatory arrangement, the commodity futures market in China's mainland has achieved many years' rapid development without any major risk incidents, and successfully withstood major impacts, including the Asian financial crisis in 1998, the global financial crisis in 2008, and the Chinese stock market's fluctuation last year. In the first half of this year, steel, iron ore, and coke market in China's mainland demonstrated signs of overheated trading, with rapid price increase and consecutive record highs of futures trading volume and turnover rate. DCE worked with other commodity futures exchanges to closely monitor the market situation and took comprehensive measures to curb excessive short-showing trading. Consequently, stable operation was restored in the market. Ladies and gentlemen, the commodity futures market in China's mainland still has very promising growth prospects. So far, commodity futures products such as crude oil and live hog have not been listed, and commodity options are yet to be launched. OTC market, including swaps and other derivatives, is still at an early stage, and overseas investors are not yet able to trade directly in the market. The Chinese government, regulators, industrial firms, and other related parties are gaining a deep understanding of commodity futures and options. We have more confidence in accelerating market reform and innovation, and there is an ever-expanding consensus on promoting market opening up. We believe that the commodity futures and options market in China's mainland will enter a new age of rapid growth as China deepens its reform and opening up. And as China continues its economic transition and upgrading, DCE is accelerating its effort in building a diversified, open, and comprehensive derivatives exchange by focusing on option listing and our futures internationalization and OTC market construction. We will keep on fostering an open, fair, and just market and maintain market order through lawful regulation. Meanwhile, we will further improve market quality and efficiency through researching, developing, and launching more products and instruments, as well as improving contract design in line with market changes. Ladies and gentlemen, we welcome overseas market institutions to follow and participate in the development and construction of the commodity futures and options market in China's mainland. We're looking forward to providing you with the best service. Thank you very much.
come join us. And thanks to Nandini and the WFE for having me once again this year. And I'm really excited to be on this panel because it's just so timely looking at volatility. I mean, for me, when I come here every year to the WFE annual event, I'm a market structure geek, so people want to talk about high-frequency trading, off-exchange trading, things like that. This year, people want to talk about the U.S. election. And so next week, we have the election, and while it looked like Hillary was running away with it, the race has really tightened up, and it has the potential to roil markets, a Trump win, I think. And I think if you look at it, even at the, you know, the electoral map maybe looks a little better for Hillary, but we have so many states that are up for grabs, and you know, think back to 2000 and Bush versus Gore and the Florida recount, and you have Trump saying that he won't necessarily respect the election results. So it has the potential to be scary, and I think it's a perfect time to think about, are our exchanges ready for that the type of volatility that could come from that. And apart from that question, I think for those of you who haven't seen the WFE paper on circuit breakers, I think it was really good survey work that was examined, and I thought it did a great job of summarizing things. So it's good that we have an opportunity to talk about some of those issues on this panel too, but make sure to take a look at that. So before we get into the topic of circuit breakers, I actually wanted to start with you, Alexander, and ask a little bit about before we have a problem, we create a problem, how do we avoid it? Chairman Lee mentioned margin. So can you maybe speak to a little bit about how we, the first line of defense, things like pre-trade risk and what you guys are doing on that front?
Thank you very much, Joe. Thank you that you are starting with me, I believe, because in opinion of many people, so Russia and volatility are to some extent synonyms. Which is not fully true, because this year we are suffering of the low volatility and are not the world leaders in that. Even UK volatility was higher.
According to Hillary, Trump and Russia are also synonyms.
Look. Look.
Sorry,
Russia is getting more and more popular here. That's a very good sign. So what we are doing by the pre-trade. So really Moscow, so to come up to manage the very high volatility which happens sometimes. So despite I said we are not the world leader this year in volatility, but we know exactly what it is. That's true. So we established some processes and procedures. Some of them are unique, some of them are common. And the unique process we established is a full pre-order validation, which means that each particular order, prior to passing to the order book of our exchange, is checked and controlled on the availability of the collateral, which, as far as we know, is really unique. The other exchanges are, or better to say, the CCPs of the other exchanges, are more exposed at the risk of the clearing participants. That is, of course, costly. However, so we established our systems in a way that the latency is very good, is around 300 milliseconds, so it is an international standard. So our systems proceeds with around up to 150,000 orders in a second. Making so up to 150 million orders checks during a day, so it will be done quite quick, and that provides us with a really unique opportunity to mitigate the probability of the flash crashes, which might be caused by some technical mistake of an HFT trader or just of a broker. Also, it provides us with an opportunity that we can achieve wider number of profiles of our market participants, because we are mitigating the risks on particular clearing members. And it is also mitigation to some extent in terms of the liquidity, in terms of volatility, because as more differently motivated participants we do have, as lower is the volatility in a particular moment. Also, it is a tool which our brokers are using. So because that is practically, so we are providing the brokers with the risk management of an exchange. They can take and go softer to their clients, but not harder. And also it limits the speculators from opening large unsecured positions.
Dennis, I wanted to turn to you and, you know, unlike Alexander here, CBOE might want to take on the title of the world leader in volatility since you guys are the big VIX guys. So I guess the question is, what do you do on the pre-trade side as well? How do you handle that piece of it?
Sure.
It'll go on, I think.
Hello? Okay. What we do is we actually look at ourselves as the last line of defense on this. We work closely with the brokers, but we have developed systems controls where we intercept inbound orders if they are super marketable and look like they would trade automatically at nonsensical prices. So what we do is when we see these, violate our reasonability checks, we route these orders to an order management book to keep them from executing automatically. And then we let the floor brokers determine whether these orders should be executed. So that's how we do it. Obviously, like other exchanges, we have obvious error rules to adjust trades in the event that orders get filled. But we've been working very hard with our order interception process and systems controls there.
Veronica, from a vendor perspective, whether it's the market access or market data delivery, because obviously market data is key to people knowing what's going on and putting in the right orders and market makers being able to be there, the resiliency of matching engines. What role does technology play here?
I think technology plays an important role, but I, as a former developer and running a technology company, I think anything can be achieved with technology. So the most important thing is that you actually understand what is it you want to protect for, and how can technology help the market and help the participant to get a safer market. And the trick here, I think, is to identifying a mistake from an actual relative price movement that you want to occur. And here, technology can play an important role in identifying the patterns and understanding if this is an error or if it's not an error.
So I want to turn to the role of regulators in all this, because that's part of it, I think, part of the equation. And a big picture question to start as to whether the regulators have enough data and information to even analyze the cause of these volatility problems. And specifically, based on some conversations I've had with Bill Brodsky, I wanted to hit you, Dennis, about some of the shortcomings maybe in the approach the regulators are taking to this.
Sure. CBOE, Bill Brodsky wrote a letter in May of 2015, 5 years after the flash crash in the U.S., explaining some of the deficiencies of the program that the centerpiece program of the SEC on their ways to get insight into items like the flash crash. So
the consolidated audit trail, right?
Pardon me?
The consolidated audit trail.
Yeah, the consolidated audit trail. And the consolidated audit trail actually came out of recommendations of a joint SEC-CFTC advisory committee where they looked at the flash crash and they said, this is something we need to identify this event prior to, figure out exactly what is going on in a better fashion. So what they have done is the SEC determined to create a comprehensive, time-synchronized audit trail of all products that are under its jurisdiction. Those include equity options, equities, and equity index options. Noticeably absent in this is CFTC products, which the SEC said, of course, are not under their jurisdiction. And notably, of course, is equity index futures and equity index options on futures. And without these two pieces, Bill noted in his article, we have a major hole in this database. In fact, the May 2010 flash crash was really triggered by trading in the equity index futures products, not equity products themselves. So without this piece of information in this comprehensive database, you have a major flaw in the database, and we're going to have a highly incomplete picture of what is going on in the world, in our markets. So here we stand in November of 2016, 6.5 years after the flash crash, and we still do not have this consolidated audit trail. And my understanding is this audit trail is going to be, the plan is going to be approved as the SEC envisioned it in the next few weeks, actually. So once it is implemented, which will be actually a couple more years from now, it will still have this incomplete database. And my hope, along with Bill's, is that it doesn't take another flash crash for us to determine that we really should have put the CFTC pieces in this database.
Yeah, I have to just chime in on this one because it seems so obvious. The flash crash report itself, which took many months to come out because they didn't have a consolidated audit trail and they had to go to each of the players. It wasn't all sitting there already, so it took some time, is going to have this major hole in it, and we're going to be in 2018, 2019 before it's even live. And I think most people don't realize in the U.S., because of the fragmentation we have among the equity markets, there is no one central repository of execution data. Again, it's accessible by requesting it from brokers, and after the fact, it could be pieced together, but that adds a whole nother layer of complexity and time to these things. So it's really almost shocking that we are, you know, we don't have that in one place, and when we finally do in a couple more years, it's not going to include the futures data. Anyway, that's just my own op-ed to add to yours and right. Bill's. So I do want to turn to circuit breakers now. So if we do get into a situation where a disruption actually happens, how do we deal with it? And I guess I want to, if maybe you guys can think about it from a philosophical perspective first, and comment on the wisdom of having a true trading halt where investors have time to catch their breath, allow time to attract contra-side liquidity and such, or is that the right approach, or do we need to ensure that trading keeps on going? And maybe we have price bands and limits on that, so trading only happens within those specified price bands, but do we need to allow trading to continue? You want to start, Alexander? I know you have pretty strong views on this.
Sure, thank you. So, indeed, so we have a long history of implementing and changing even some of our procedures within the last 15 years in Moscow. So in 2008, we used the trading halts in the securities market, especially in the equities market. Since that time, we re-established our risk management systems, and now we are using a combination of limit up, limit down, of the call option, call auctions, and in combination with some other measures, like for instance, limiting short selling and so on. So why we've done it? It's really a philosophical question. I agree with you, Joe. So what is the target of the CCP in terms of the risk management? Of course, to make the CCP itself pretty safe. Yeah. So that is the first target because it has a special value. But also the continuing pricing, the continuing price formation is also a very, very valued thing for our customers, for our market participants. halting the trading does not mean that the panic is out and the price formation is also out, because we have OTC market. Some of the assets might be traded in different venues with different regulations and with different rules for the risk management. And stopping, and so full halt of the trading in the biggest, in the main venue, so might even cause increase of the panic. So that is our lesson. So that's why we are using, as I mentioned already, so different, so combination of the different measures without trading halts. Again, so liquidity and continuous price formation is for us not less important as mitigating over volatility.
Chairman Lee, any thoughts on trading halts and circuit breakers? How do you handle that at your exchange?
Yeah, thank you, Joe. Actually, in China mainland, you know, we several future exchanges use the price limit well, and this mechanism is works very well, I think. Actually, we just I mentioned we have set up a dynamic mechanism for the setting price limit. For example, in DCE, if the price keep on the limit in the five minutes before the market close, we will increase the price limit in the following days. And simultaneously, we will increase the marginal levels. For example, in the iron ore contract, the first day, I mean, currently the price limit is 6%, and the margin level is 8%. And if today the price is keeping on the limit before the market closing, for the 5 minutes, the following day the margin will increase 8%, and the price limit will increase the 8%. I think this mechanism works well, I think. Yeah.
Dennis, how do you guys handle it?
Well, looking at this from our perspective, what we do is our guideline is the order is the market acting fair and orderly, and is price discovery occurring? And so a couple of recent examples we had were August 24th, 2015, and the Brexit, where we had our markets open in extended trading hours. On August 24th, 2015, the markets were in a stressed condition. So the VIX index, which is based on S&P index options, obviously it is the international benchmark for volatility. It had some extraordinary volatility, and because the S&P 500 index options were having difficulty getting prices, the market makers were in a stressed position. They were still there, and so it wasn't pretty necessarily, but the market was still operating. So they were working very hard to get prices and create their market. At the same time, VIX index futures and options were trading without interruption at all. They were their market was functioning perfectly fine. So from that perspective, price discovery was occurring as we expected. So given that. The market was functioning. After 9 o'clock Chicago time, the S&P 500 market makers began to adjust their models a little bit, and so they could keep their quotes in a little bit better. And so the VIX index was able to be calculated. And so within a half hour, the markets were operating fine. So that was their one experience. Then the Brexit experience, we had an issue where the information of the Brexit vote was trickling into our marketplace and into the equity index futures marketplace at the same time. And as the vote began to become determined that it was a leave Brexit, leave the European Union, the markets began to gain, have a little stress. But what we did is we if at all possible, if we go by the guideline of fair and orderly markets. And so if our markets are operating properly, we will try to keep them open. So in that case, we watched the markets. S&P 500 index market went limit down. They went down to its 5% limit on the downside. But our market was still functioning. Our markets, we had bids and offers and trades going on. And so we kept our market open. And as the vote became more certain, we still kept our market open. But what as this occurred, we determined, the market is getting thin, but it is still operating perfectly well. And then finally, the S&P 500 market came off of its down limit and started trading again. And the VIX index futures and options, the price of began to be trading at a lower level. So we feel vindicated that we kept the market open to allow the price discovery to occur during this time. And so generally speaking, we are going to try to keep our markets open as long as the market is functioning. If it's not functioning, we certainly will do something different.
Yeah, so the way I look at it is if you use the known analogy about the exchanges being the infrastructure players and they are providing the roads, and on the roads are the cars are driving and that's the traders, and the brokers are selecting the car they want to use. And I think then it's the exchanges and the marketplace interest to have traffic lights, you have to have your rule book, you have to have signs so those cars know how to behave. But if there is an accident, it's the cars that are actually being hit. But I think the responsibility of the exchanges is if they want those cars on the street, they must provide an environment where you avoid as many accidents as possible. And I think that is the trick. So spontaneously you can think, or I would think, keep the market open because you want to be able to go in or out of your position, and you should always be able to trade. But I think the trick is to define, is this a fair and orderly market, and is it functioning properly? And that is the one that has the answer to how quickly and automatically to define that has the answer in how to behave. Because of course, you can allow for certain price movements or up and down, but if you then have identified them, you can choose to either halt your market or actually just don't allow orders outside of the price bands. And because then you still have the market open, and the marketplace can determine if they're going to move the price bands or how, what is a fair and orderly market. So I think from the solution we build, we offer either you that you halt the market or that you don't allow prices to occur outside a certain price limits.
The August 24th, 2015 incident near the open was very interesting, because some of the solutions that were put in place following the flash crash, which I would say largely worked. At first it was single stock circuit breakers, and then it went to the limit up, limit down regime. And I think it largely worked over the ensuing 5 or so years. But what ended up happening is, because they had pretty tight limits, we ended up triggering a bunch of stocks. So the individual flash crashes, if you will, exacerbated or rolled up into a bigger market-wide event. And particularly, it takes me to another point, the interconnectedness of markets, because what happened there was we had some blue chip names that were moving 10-20%, and then the ETFs got all messed up, and then the bands of the ETFs were breached or were hit, and therefore then all these ETFs weren't opening as well. So it was sort of a confluence of events. So I guess when I think about the interconnectedness of markets, it's both equities and derivatives within markets. It's equities and ETFs. We talked about futures and the impact there. But I want to talk a little bit about other markets, meaning different geographies. And the one that fascinates me a little bit is the Russian situation, where we have some GDRs that trade in size in London and some of the more liquid names, and most of the other activity obviously happens in Russia. And how do you look at that? You know, were something to happen in London, some type of fat finger problem or technology problem or whatever, liquidity issue, and does it, should you be coordinated with that? Should you not be coordinated? And let's start with you on that one.
Yes, Joe, in a perfect world, it should be definitely coordinated. But frankly speaking, I'm not as optimistic today about it because of many reasons. So ideally, it should be either one place where the whole liquidity is concentrated, or it should be really a very strong harmonization done on some international level. There are two good alternatives, but that are not alternatives of today, I believe. The third alternative might be, and it is not a good alternative, rather a bad alternative, that risk management is also a tool of competition. If one CCP has a stronger risk management and introduces some trading halts, and the other CCP is not doing it, working for another exchange, so it might be treated as some sort of a competitive advantage. And some exchanges are making use of it. So that's why I'm thinking, so we should, I believe, in under umbrella of WFE, start opening some international discussion among the exchanges about it. But frankly speaking, I'm rather a bit pessimistic in that regard, because it depends also on some technicalities, like, for instance, we in our world, so to say, of the Moscow risk management, we are establishing a bit different rules, and daily are changing also the individual margin requirements for each particular product, depending on the market structure, depending on some expectations, depending on our formulas and calculations, and on the liquidity. And the same product or similar product might have different conditions or trade on with very different conditions on different venues. So that's why the rules applying in the same matter to all the venues, so it, to me, it is today not imaginable, frankly speaking.
You want to chime in on that, Dennis?
Yeah, actually, I agree with that. Markets around the world are completely different. I agree there should be some integration, but it would be hard for us to have a one-size-fits-all approach on this sort of thing, because the markets are different. There's liquidity differences, CCP capacities are different, and you're choosing winners and losers based on a prescription. That would be a nonsensical deal. As Alexander would probably say, there are competitive advantages that one would have, one market might have. They might have a better way of handling these than another a market would have. So it's I agree there should be coordination, but the devil's in the detail, and this is actually a good, very good forum to discuss this sort of thing, because we have a lot of people here looking at open markets and trying to keep the ability for capital formation to continue, and this is a very rational group for discussing that.
But there is also, you can have the risk control in different levels. So this is for the marketplace, but you can also, I mean, in a global world, the FCMs, for example, they can also have similar risk control in place for their members. So if there was a more real-time world, if marketplaces and CCPs could distribute things in real-time, and you as an FCM or a clearing member could actually monitor your client's portfolio in real-time and knowing the risk across all the markets, that will give them a much, much safer toolbox than they have today, where the information is just not available. So I think all the responsibility is not only on the exchanges, but it's also one step outside of the exchanges.
Excuse me, Joe, maybe some small additions just as an example. So prior to the Brexit result, we in Moscow, because we are trading also FX spot, and we increased, according to our sole decision, the margin, the individual margins for pound ruble exchange rate, so the pair of currencies. So because the probability of the Brexit was not zero, and that is for us already a sign, so to think about doing something. Our colleagues in other venues did not do it because of their calculation of risks or their understanding of the probability of the event. Yeah. So, well, how it can be coordinated, I don't know.
So, to make sure Nandini invites me back, I want to get us back on track. We started a little late, but I do want to open it up real quickly for any hot questions anyone has. And if not, I'll ask my final question. But anyone out there with a question? Post-launch stupor. Okay, we have one? Okay. They disappeared? Okay. It was one of these.
I saw one.
You saw one, you sure?
I saw one.
Okay. Phantom liquidity. So I want to ask the question about, again, taking a step back and looking at totally alternative approaches. And that is, the example I'm going to use is market maker liquidity. And maybe it's a difficult one to have when we had Daniel Coleman and talking about the, you know, changes in bank liquidity disappearing. But is there any opportunity to have any type of market making programs where we can have people step in, or is that also just sort of unrealistic? Obviously, people don't want to step in front of a falling knife, but on the other hand, there could be a role if market makers are making money normally and are part of programs that have incentives from the exchanges, there is the potential that they can stand by in other circumstances. Any thoughts on, and it doesn't have to be that alternative, but anything else we could hit on this front?
Yeah, frankly speaking, the interest of an exchange and the interest of the market maker are to some extent opposite, yeah? So we are paying to the market makers because the product is not liquid enough. They like to be market maker in a very liquid product because it's easier and cheaper and less risky, of course. So the same is applying to the situation of the over volatility. We are talking about over volatility. Of course, the fundamental volatility caused by fundamental reasons shall not be mitigated, shall not be stopped. The problem is some unique volatility in a certain period of time. So according to our market maker programs, so the obligation of market makers usually is to provide some pricing for a certain period of time and percentage during the day. Of course, we are convincing them and trying that the prices will be always available, especially in the periods of a high volatility. But that is a special danger, a special risk for them, first of all. Yeah. So, and that's why, of course, they are avoiding setting up pricing according to valid agreements exactly in those periods of times, so which is logical, of course. I do not see, frankly speaking, some reasonable ways how to convince the market makers to take extremely risks in the periods of the extreme liquidity for the same money.
Go ahead, Dennis.
Yeah, I agree with that. If I'm CBOE and I'm looking for a monetary incentive for my market makers to make markets in highly stressed times, I don't have enough money to do that sort of thing. The market makers would require a great deal of money, and even with that, my guess is if they are in survival mode, there is no way that they are going to make markets, sensible markets, even with monetary payments to do this sort of thing. It's highly unrealistic to expect them to do that because they are in survival mode. They provide a very important risk transfer service, and they're trying to survive to the next day at that point in time.
Okay, please join me in thanking our panelists. Great job.
thank you all. You were great, and Joe, you're invited back to everything. For our final panel of today, titled titled Market Infrastructures of the Future 2017 and Beyond, we have, I can see Daniela, I can see Chitra, Sunil, and if the panelists would join me on stage after the photographs, that would be great.
I saw him in the washroom. Oh, he's coming.
Thank you for coming back, Rashid. Be careful. Thank you all for joining us. Here to moderate the panel is Sunil Benimadhu, CEO of Stock Exchange of Mauritius, and a dear member of the WFE fraternity. To my immediate right, Daniela Peterhoff, Global Head of Market Infrastructure at Oliver Wyman, and who was so instrumental in that great report that we've produced on enhancing liquidity in emerging markets. To her right, how appropriate, our new chair, Chitra Ramkrishna, CEO of the National Stock Exchange of India. Then we have Sunil, and to Sunil's right, we have Hugh Jenkins, Vice Chairman of BTG Pactual, and finally, Rashid Al-Mansoori, who heads the Qatar Stock Exchange and was our host last year. Thank you all for joining us. We're looking forward to hearing from you on the future.
Thank you, Nandini. Good afternoon, everybody, and it gives me immense pleasure to chair and moderate this last panel on a very interesting and yet disruptive topic, Market Infrastructures of the Future 2017 and Beyond. Before I kickstart the discussion, I just wanted to make a few introductory remarks. We all know that financial markets and the stock exchange industry has witnessed more transformational changes during the last 15 years than they have during the last 100 previous years. Secondly, we also know today that stock exchanges or the stock exchange industry are growingly being criticized for moving away from their historical mission of providing funding to companies and fueling economic growth to embrace new objectives like embracing liquidity for the purpose of liquidity. Thirdly, on the technology front, We also know that new technologies are disrupting long-established operating models, and there is a growing feeling today that cloud computing and the advent of blockchain technology could potentially unleash strong disruptive forces that are likely to change the way we operate and our business models. So within this highly volatile and shifting framework, it is useful for us to ask a few key questions. What are some of the key transformational changes that are likely to characterize the near and long-term future of financial market infrastructures? How do we view the long-term future of the capital markets industry? Are the centers of international finance shifting? Are mergers and acquisitions going to transform our industry's landscape? So to answer these questions and many more, I have the great pleasure of having a very distinguished panel, group of panelists among us. On my left, there is Chitra Ramkrishna, Managing Director and Chief Executive of National Stock Exchange of India. On her left, there is Daniela Peterhoff, who is a partner of Oliver Wyman. On my right, Hugh Jenkins, Vice Chairman of the Board, BTG Pactual. And then, of course, on my far right, my good friend Rashid Al-Mansoori, CEO of the Qatar Stock Exchange. So panelists, good afternoon. I will kickstart with you, Chitra, very quickly. We all know that the National Stock Exchange of India has been instrumental in driving change within the Indian capital markets landscape. You were the first to introduce automated trading. You were the first to move to a demutualized market infrastructure, ownership structure. So as we look towards 2020, what are some of the key disruptive changes that you foresee within the Indian Stock Exchange or capital markets landscape?
So a lot of the changes that I perceive reflecting in India will definitely be concomitant to the changes that we are seeing around the world. If I have to just put it into three buckets, I think first and foremost, which is much talked about, and I can see definitely some of that in India as well, that platforms which are doing the function that we conventionally do, maybe for different asset classes or other securities or other customers, are definitely finding traction. And so as we go ahead, certainly there will be comparable, competitive platforms, more in a fintech space, not really called markets, which will keep arising. And therefore, I think as an exchange, for example, we have to continue to look at whether we will be able to provide similar services, better services to the customers by adopting, embracing some of those platforms or doing something different. On the second front, definitely we see a trend towards non-conventional intermediaries. So, you know, the conventional intermediaries of broker-dealers, of course, exist. But for example, in a country like India, where the penetration, geographical penetration, etc., is quite large, the broker-dealers will inevitably depend upon non-conventional intermediaries to really reach out to the end customer. And hitherto, that hierarchical model worked. But I think soon we will start to see many of these non-conventional intermediaries doing the service for reaching customers.
And can you be more precise? What kind of
so, for example, advisors, for example, you know, the people who sell an insurance product, the people who sell a savings product, but not necessarily an exchange financial asset. So these will all be intermediaries that will be available, and we'll have to see a way in which we can integrate and improve the distribution network, perhaps by encompassing them. The third set of changes that I definitely perceive happening is, though it is linked to technology, but I think technology is going to help us improve our cost models for the ultimate customer. So whether it's a question of capital efficiency or whether it is a question of better analytics and intelligence that we are going to use. But the pressure is going to continue to be on us to see how we can improve the cost structures for the end customer. And I think a lot of interesting technologies will emerge which we can use as market infrastructure to deliver some of this.
Okay. I just have a quick follow-up question to what you said, Chitra. When I look at the Indian market, of course, we see fundamental changes that have happened over the last 20 years, thanks to the contribution that NSE has brought to the market landscape. But overall, I still see that out of a population of 1 billion people or more in India, I think less than 2 or 3% of these people are investors on the stock exchange. So it shows that the potential for growth is great in India, but at the same time, it shows that given the fact that the Indian capital markets have been in existence for nearly 2 decades with BSE prior to your coming into play, what explains that you have been unable to reach out to a larger cross-section of the population in terms of, you know, selling your products?
You know, at the heart of this question is something that there are really two things that I want to highlight. First and foremost, in the Indian context, all retail savings into the market were really direct retail savings. And typically in any market, if you see, it's really the indirect retail savings, whether through the retiral monies or through the mutual fund structures, which are the first ones to come into the market, and then that creates a momentum for the direct retail savings to come. In India, this has been the exact opposite. So in a sense, it was always direct retail savings, and it's only in the last few years that you have started to see indirect retail savings come into the market. In fact, it's only 18 months ago that the large governmental provident fund monies have started to come into the market. So I think that's a bit of a game changer. The second, of course, is I think digital access is really helping us improve that penetration. For example, in the last year, mobile alone has seen a huge traction in terms of increasing the number of clients accessing the exchange. So one has to look at more digital ways of improving that number, really.
Okay. Rashid, I just want to ask you a question. If, you know, the last 10 years has seen, of course, within the capital market space, globally, the emergence of multi-asset class global exchanges. And I would say, in a certain sense, the concentration of liquidity across asset classes on these globalized platforms. So how do small emerging exchanges like Qatar Exchange continue to remain relevant in this environment of globalization?
Yeah, I think we are seeing lately that merging happening, and we see something happening soon, like, you know, between Deutsche Börse and LSE and other big exchanges in the world. But still, the small exchanges has advantage. Especially if we look at what they are talking about the distributed technology or about the what's happened in the big market, we still see an interest in our newly emerging market. We still have an advantage. Yes, we still single stock exchanges, but there is a lot on in the region to offer for the international investor. And we could see that, if you remember in 2014, when Qatar Stock Exchange entered the MSCI index, one day trading was 4 billion, where was the average daily turnover for Qatar Stock Exchange at that time was only 300 million. And we saw the interest of the international investor. I mean, in the first quarter of that year, we had account opening equal to the previous year, which happened on 2013. So even though we see, you know, a big merger happening and big funds outside the region, but the interest is still on the region. But I think it's the responsibility now of the local exchanges to work and to promote themselves. I think we still need to promote ourselves. We are not doing enough, I think, even though we take our blue chip company to some financial cities, but that will not be enough. There is still some regulatory issues on the region that we need to tackle. In some state on the GCC where I am from, the exchanges established before the regulator, and they were mostly self-regulated exchanges, and things was easy. I will tell you, for example, in Qatar, we have 44 listed companies. 40 of them was over the last 22 years before the regulator. Okay, I'm glad that my regulator is not here today to hear me. But and in the last 5 years, we only listed 3 or 4 companies, which is really pity because there's a potential there in our market. So I think the regulators on the region need to really not only look to the market from outside and just policing the market, but I think they should be a partner on the development of the stock exchanges, products, making it a friendly market for the international investors, and making it receptive for the listed companies. But I think still in the region we have a lot to offer for the international investor and funds.
Okay, thank you. Hugh, I just want to get to you. You know, according to Accenture, investment in blockchain activities related to capital market space has grown from $30 million in 2014 to 75 in 2015, with estimates that the number can reach 400 million by 2020. So do you think that blockchain is a truly disruptive force capable of replacing legacy infrastructure within the capital market space, or do you think there's a lot of hype currently regarding blockchain? I know you're not a specialist in technology, but you are a market operator. I just wanted to have your views on that.
Sunil, thank you very much, and good afternoon, everybody. I think one thing that's very clear is that costs are becoming a consistently more significant issue as returns in the market continue to be under pressure from a low interest rate environment, from the low levels of growth we see in most of the economies of the world. Mm-hmm. And so I think anything which results in standardization and unitization of the cost base of securities trading is bound to be impactful. And I think that as we look at the amount of expenditure that's being incurred in the clearing and settlement environment, it continues to be very significant as far as I can see. If I look at our operations in BTG Pactual, and therefore the ability to drive those costs down by having more of a standardized offering, blockchain offering the ability, as I understand it, and as you rightly point out, my knowledge is neither as a technologist or as an accountant. There'll be real opportunities, I think, for this kind of technology to allow more people to have access to the market and to allow markets to become more efficient and therefore ultimately improve returns to investors. So I'm not sure it'll be disruptive, but I certainly think it'll be enabling in terms of allowing more people to participate in the market.
Daniela, how do you think exchanges can embrace more digital innovation and not become marginalized by new players? I remember yesterday in our discussions, Andreas was emphasizing that change within our industry is too slow compared to change that are continuously being embraced by the likes of Google or Apple and so on. So, do you think the future threats will come from these platforms rather than from within ourselves? And if yes, well, how do we react to that?
I think my answer to this is probably twofold. So I think on the one hand, we need to pay attention to these platforms and understand why are they establishing...
Sorry, can you speak close to the...
Yeah. Why are they establishing foothold in the market? Why are they getting attractive to the community? So I think we need to be mindful of that. And from the exchange perspective, try to shape our relationship with the clients that they acquire to understand whether we could extend our service to actually cater to them. That is one area. I think I would, beyond that, I do see that a lot of these platforms lack the natural legacy of an exchange in terms of the regulated model. They won't be able to expand that franchise to the level that the exchanges can. So as a result of that, I think it's a mixture of trying to develop similar models, more of a defensive play. But then on the other hand, looking at areas of potential collaboration with their clients to get closer to why the market is shifting in that direction.
Okay. Chitra, yesterday I remember Arunma was saying that, in her views, stock exchanges constitute very powerful agents of social transformation, very powerful agents of economic growth, and so on. And yet, when you look at the view out there, it seems that we've been struggling to get this messaging out in a very clear manner. So where have we failed as exchanges to get people understand the clear transformational role that we are playing, that we are powerful platforms for economic democratization, that thanks to exchanges, investors have had access to the growth story of many of the flagship companies around the world, and without us, this would not have been possible. And yet, when you talk to people outside of the industry, it seems that we are struggling. So where are we failing on that front? And what should we be doing differently?
I think this is something that the entire industry will, you know, debate and find some solution for. But the fact of the matter is that we continue to be perceived as larger public utilities and people delivering larger public good. And in some sense, I think the messaging is what is the amount of contribution that we make is something that's taken for granted. And I think it's important that we are able to translate that into costs, benefits, and put it out to our respective policy jurisdictions as well as to, you know, the world outside the market space. But having said that, I think at this point when there is a lot of questions around market-based financing, for example, and policy and governments are seized with how this can perhaps give them a solution for larger, you know, economic issues that they're contending with. I think as an industry, if we are able to go up with solutions, whether it is a question of SME financing or whether it is a question of debt markets, it's very clear that there is no solution that's already in the box which can be seized. But our intention that we want markets to play that role and therefore engage with policy and with regulators and, you know, people like the multilateral agencies to say that if we want market-based financing to play this role, then these are the kind of interventions that would be of great support, that will lead us down that path. For example, the often, challenge that we all face is that while markets are different from banks, a lot of the time we struggle with having to fit into a bank framework. But if we want to deliver something different, then we need to go out and ask for that framework. And hopefully, if that is going to give a solution that policy desires, we will be able to create those solutions. And I think, therefore, there is actually an opportunity for us to test our ability to go and provide a larger public good in the near future.
I just want to move on and look at the landscape of international finance. It would seem, Hugh, that the centers of international finance seem to be shifting, and it would seem also that some of the developed market exchanges are today facing a growing challenge to their dominance. So in your view, where will be the leading financial markets be in the future, and which regions are likely to garner new business going forward?
As you say, the winds of change. The winds of change are moving quite quickly through markets. I think that in particular, we're now seeing interconnectivity allowing people to move to investment venues that they weren't able to reach before. And you look at the way in which global flows have impacted commodity prices, impacted foreign exchange markets, impacted securities prices on the basis of political shifts in, for example, Brexit, and the consequences that Brexit had for markets throughout the world. And you recognize that markets are becoming more and more interconnected. Therefore, I'm not sure that sort of a venue in a physical sense or a geographic sense is as relevant these days as it was in the past, where you had to interact physically in a particular marketplace. As we look at investment flows, and we look at people searching for growth and return in the world, clearly it seems as though there are opportunities in the emerging markets. in terms of returns, which we're no longer seeing in Europe and the US. In terms of the dominance of particular financial centers, it's hard to see how New York's dominance is going to fade given the locus of capital there. Clearly, in Europe, it's going to be fascinating. I'd say Brexit, I think, is going to have very profound consequences for London. I find it very hard to see how the infrastructure that's currently in London and the investment that's required to maintain that infrastructure there can survive in a more fragmented European capital market. When we look at what's going on within this part of the world and the growth in, for example, MELA and the initiatives to sort of bring liquidity to the region, I think we can see, you know, room for quite considerable growth. But to my mind, what's really happening more than anything else is that capital is moving so much more freely. People are so used to being able to interconnect and reach securities markets throughout the world at a touch of a button, that everything's becoming more volatile and more fluid. But somehow, in the last sort of 12 months, especially with the development of sort of populism, you know, we have a very important election on Tuesday in the United States where both of the leading candidates are talking about increasing barriers and trade protection. In my home country, you have the Prime Minister talking about foreign investment review in what's been one of the most open markets in the world. We have this enabling technology which is allowing capital to move wherever returns are available, but at the same time, national governments starting to talk about protectionism and reducing the freedom of movement of capital. So I think that's bound to result in a more diversified kind of trading venue. People are going to want to be able to access national markets rather than seeing concentration within particular financial centers in the way in which we've seen it in the last 30 years.
Okay. Rashid, I just want to zoom in on the MENA region. What, in your view, what are some of the key disruptive changes that you foresee within the next 5 to 10 years within the MENA region, in the way those stock exchanges operate, in the way the capital markets are currently structured?
Well, I think the main challenges now, and it's not what is happening on the outside world, but it's really maybe the technology and maybe people talk about the Brexit, but I think what's concerned us is what's happening in the region itself. Okay, because what happens in the financial sector is not that, I mean, in Europe, it will not really directly affect us in Qatar because we are a small exchanges and the effect will be small, but it could affect bigger exchanges. What's really worry us on the region is the geopolitical stuff around our exchanges. This is a real main concern, and this could really make the international investor a little nervous about the region. And that's really what worry us, and that's what we try to give them a confidence on a state like Qatar, like UAE, and other very peaceful. There is stability there, and there is no issue. But still, I mean, the regional geopolitical issues, what's happening in Syria, what's happening in Iraq, in Yemen, is really making, as I say, the international investor a little nervous about, you know, moving. And we saw this. And also what's happening in the international economy, like, you know, we saw the falling prices on oil, and most of our countries rely on oil, and that really has its own effect on the region.
I just want to refer to what I've read in the press over the last 1 or 2 years. There's been a lot of talk of the setting up of GIFT, the Gujarat International Financial and Technology City, the first international smart city of its kind in India. So can you please tell us a little bit more about GIFT and how disruptive will the implementation of GIFT be to the current structure of Indian capital markets, if any?
So the vision and the purpose of setting up GIFT, as you know, it was a project that was conceived when the current Prime Minister was in Gujarat. The whole idea was to create an internationally competitive zone for different services. And there are parts of that that are already operational. More from the pointed purpose of the markets, in the GIFT, exchanges will be able to operate in an internationally competitive framework. So which really means that the regulatory framework which applies there, the products that will be allowed there, and the you know, transactions and other things that will happen there, will be something where it is in some sense like the offshore market for India. And as our you know, as our central bank said when this was first initiated, they said the whole purpose of creating something like this is to see if we can bring back a lot of the offshore activity onshore. So the idea is that it would be additive. It would help India create a space where products and participants which we were hitherto unable to attract on the domestic onshore market, we will still be able to attract through an IFSC framework, an International Financial Center kind of a framework. It's very much, it's progressing very fast, and they are expecting that in the next few months or so, it will be operationalized even from a markets perspective.
Okay. Daniela, there's a lot of talk about the importance of post-trade digitization to automate the heavily manual processes that still exist with regard to compliance, collateral management, securities, lending, and so on. So can you tell us in broad lines how you think post-trade digitization can be implemented, and how can this really improve the way the market infrastructure today is set up?
Sure. So I think, I mean, we need to look back at the history to answer this. I think we need to look back at the history of how these services were delivered traditionally. And I think in many of the markets present here, the services have been delivered in a fragmented manner that has evolved over time, which is changing due to regulation, due to implications of technology innovation, and essentially also trader requirements of using not too many different venues, aiming to consolidate. That is one trend we see. The other trend is certainly around cost pressure on the clients of the exchanges, pressure to create utilities in the post-trade space in particular, and we've seen over the past 3 to 5 years various initiatives around that. So we believe as a firm, and having also done a few studies around this and around, for example, blockchain and post-trade, we believe that there will be areas of disruption that are natural because there are too many intermediaries in this space. And we think for specific isolated asset classes in local markets, this is the ideal test case for blockchain post-trade application or a more digital use of those processes. We still believe in the large markets, as we see from, for example, T2S in Europe, but also other platform initiatives, how hard it is to really create a consolidated infrastructure that goes across different service levels. So I think the short answer is yes for niche markets, niche asset classes, and related efficiencies if there are few market participants involved. But on a very large scale, we don't think this will materialize, at least in the next 2 to 3 years. 5+ years, potentially.
Okay. Hugh, mergers and acquisitions, they seem to be dictating currently the fate of a few big exchanges, with a number of high-profile cross-border mergers being announced, Deutsche Börse London, BATS and CBOE, and so on. Do you believe that this trend can be expected to continue? Who's next, according to you?
I have no idea who's next, so I won't even attempt to speculate on that. I think, you know, during my career, one of the most interesting developments has been the demutualization of exchanges. Mm. And clearly, one of the things which that resulted in was a shift from an organization which was really designed to serve the purposes of its members, and largely was a sort of trade protection activity to a growth-orientated company. And if you look at the way in which that's resulted in creating additional competition, creating additional capital to invest in reducing the cost of transactions on an exchange, creating new products, attracting new investors, I think it's very hard to say that's been anything other than fantastic for the development of securities markets. But I think the idea of significant consolidation in the industry has some dangers to it. And you're right.
What are these dangers?
What are the dangers? Well, I think it's very interesting. You know, if you look at the benefits that people would propose for exchange mergers, it relates to reducing transactional cost, simplification of processes, growth of data capture, which allows you to sell more data to your as one of your revenue streams. I think on the other side of it, you know, technologists tend to like working for small companies, not big companies. Competition comes from diversity and people competing for the attention of investors, rather than us resulting in a situation where you have too much power and too much concentration in the hands of a few. And my purpose of making the comment about demutualization at the start was I think there's a danger with some of these very large mergers that we wind up recreating the vehicle that we were trying to get away from in the first place, where it becomes something of a monopoly, looking to protect the interests of its participants, rather than trying to find ways to create new markets, grow new things, find different ways of reducing the cost of transacting. And I think one of the examples, when I was on my way here on a rather long flight, I took the chance to sort of read up a little bit of the research on exchanges. And one model that people talk about is exchanges looking a bit like media companies. And they're focusing on being content providers. And that content is largely price information. And that therefore, there's a strong desire to sort of consolidate as much price information in one set of hands as you can. And I think with that, there comes some risks that you lose efficiency, you start finding that you're having to pay monopoly pricing, and that the barriers to entry go up rather than down. So I think that my suspicion is that just as in banking, we found that there were diseconomies of scale. I think with these mergers, we're going to start to see some diseconomies of scale. So I suspect that although you may be right, there may be some more mega mergers between European and US exchanges or between Chinese and US exchanges, wherever it might be. I think that the trend will reverse over a period of time because it will result in a reduction in innovation and an increase in costs.
Okay, Chitra, do you share his views, or you think that we should be going around along this merger route because this is going to reduce costs, make liquidity increase, and be really purposeful for the end users, which are the investors?
So I think you've answered that question because, you know, as long as a consolidation or a merger is able to realize the benefits that you just articulated, clearly there will be a winning piece that any of the participants will look at. But on the other hand, I don't see this as substitutes for each other. You know, the point that you made about the cross-product alliances, cross-distribution arrangements between markets, between exchanges, I think those are par for the course. That is something that exchanges will continue to look at for expanding their footprint, for expanding, you know, product offerings that they can give their members, as well as reach out to members in other geographies and so on. So those business alliances or strategic alliances between markets and exchanges are not really a substitute for, one-off large, pieces of assets or two exchanges coming together.
I'll just turn to the floor. I mean, Are there questions for our panelists on the subject? Yes, please. First, gentleman, and then Arunma.
Sorry, Sunil had said first the gentleman.
Yeah, go ahead.
So I think he's being a gentleman. Okay. Thank you. I have a comment to make, which I had wanted to make yesterday, but you've given me an opportunity to make that comment in your request to the chairman to react to the issue I raised about the powerful agents that exchanges are. One of the things that I wanted to get a chance to say to this audience is that I do believe that the World Federation of Exchanges is even more critical today going forward because of the role in advocacy, in making sure there's clarity of your brand. And therefore, one question that I had for you all is, I hope you're funding the World Federation of Exchanges well. And if you're not, I'm calling on all of you to make sure that you're actually funding it well, because it's a very important vehicle for you. They can be the independent advocate when you need it in country. They can reconcile best practice to enable you be advocates for what you want to do. And I'm really serious about it. I was on the board of IOSCO, and these were issues that I was concerned about in this period where people are uncomfortable about, you know, whether you work for your shareholders or you work for the world. It's important that advocacy groups are strengthened so that it can really play their role well. Thank you.
Thank you, Arunma. So what's your take on this, Chitra, the new chairman of World Federation?
I think we continue to want to do things that will keep our industry relevant and contributing to precisely, you know, the kind of work that you articulated and we just sort of shared a few minutes ago. So I think you will find a lot of very, very willing evangelists in this room who want to take up the, you know, the cause of how we can take this message across that we believe market infrastructure is delivering public good, and how can we be used more, and how can we be more at the center of financing.
Daniela, you want
to fund WFE well?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Sorry. Can you hear me? Yeah, you can maybe.
Do you have me? Yeah, okay. So I wanted to come back with a consultant answer to this, which is that from our perspective over the last year or two, seeing how the World Federation has started to be so active in advocacy, in commenting on the key papers and on the key perspectives on the industry that have been put out, this is, from our perspective, extremely powerful in shaping the focus of the industry, but also bringing this group together, because some of the areas of impact don't affect you all to the same extent. So obviously, it needs a bit of an integrating force on the one hand, which I think is very strongly fulfilled. On the other hand, there's also this requirement to focus on the local specifics and to highlight that whenever there may be a case where that is not immediately visible, such as, for example, on CCPs, compliance, recovery and resolution, etc. So I do think that is the exact right path.
Thank you. Yes?
Okay, thank you very much for the very informative panel. I'm just putting this question to all panelists. We're all talking about embracing the new technology, okay? And what I take from embracing as the most of the cases, it's just about bringing better efficiencies. But what if a technology is just a game changer, like the blockchain technology? I think it's not more about efficiency, it's defining a new paradigm. And this paradigm, actually, there are signs of it, say, in social trading or crowdfunding. So my question is, as exchanges, are we following a correct path in dealing with these new paradigm-defining technologies, or we will wake up someday and see that, well, our places have been redefined by some fintech startup companies?
You want to take that?
Yeah, thank you. I think it's a really interesting question. To my mind, we face a fascinating moment in the development of capital markets. You know, as long as I've been in this business, there have been three forces that have been driving change in behavior. Disintermediation, regulation, which has all kinds of unintended consequences, and technology. And as Sunil pointed out, I'm not a technologist, so I won't dream of trying to answer how enabling this technology is for new business models. But if you look at, I'll give you two stats and make a couple of comments. There was a report from S&P that was reported in the FT a couple of weeks ago that said 99% of active funds in Europe had underperformed their benchmark in the last 10 years. And then this morning, Daniel Coleman told us that the JSK ETF has a spread that is 10% of the spread on the underlying high yield bonds. And thirdly, we've seen throughout the world banks pulling back because of regulatory pressure from providing risk capital. So you'd think all of those things must create new business models. And surely exchange technology or exchange business models or environments are the obvious way to deliver that, whether it's crowdfunding, whether it's these new shadow banking models which are looking to deploy capital into long-term financing opportunities. And one of the things I think that's happened in the last decade, and I'd be interested in the views of the rest of the panel and indeed of the audience, is I think there's been a phenomenal degree of development in trading and settlement technology, and very little development in terms of actual financial instruments technology. So we haven't created the kind of saving vehicles or the kind of funding vehicles that I think this technology and the legislation around exchanges should allow us to do. And that's very important in a world in which we have an aging population, an underfunded pension a liability for the world as a whole, and a lack of risk capital to let companies grow. So I think there's a phenomenal business model opportunity. I absolutely agree with you.
I just want to say that I think that's the question that will keep every exchange head sleepless. So it's a constant question and soul searching that, you know, hopefully we are not missing opportunities. But we must remember that being in a business that is regulated, there is always a lag between a model that emerges and how it fits into a regulatory framework and how you're able to adopt it and then scale it. So the short answer is, yeah, in spirit, we have to, you know, be on our toes, but there is a lag always in, you know, customizing and making it to scale.
Thank you. Any question? Last question from the audience for our panelists? Okay. So if there is no other question, I just wanted to maybe wrap up this panel by asking one question to all our panelists. We've all been talking about fundamental shifts in the exchange space, technology change, new competitors emerging, different business models that will shape our industry going forward. So if you have to summarize all these discussions in a few words, how different do you think the stock exchange landscape is going to look like, let's say, 10 years down the road? Are we going to be, if we convene again 10 years down the road, and what will be so different from what it is like today? I start with you, Rashid.
For our exchange in the region, I think we, as I said, we are still young exchanges, so we still need to develop the product offering in our market, introducing new tools for the investor. We see exchanges, bigger exchanges, all the exchanges is moving from being a traditional exchange to a company owning exchange and investing in different other sectors. But for us at the region, even though we have ambition also to follow the steps of the bigger exchanges, but still we need to focus on developing our market and introducing a new product and new tools, incentivizing more listing, especially in the sector of family-owned companies, and so on.
I have absolutely no idea, but I think that what technology, legislation, demutualization, etc., has provided us with is an incredible degree of transparency and standardization, which have allowed people to transact in volumes that they've never seen before. My suspicion is that in the next decade, what we'll really see is a phenomenal growth in customization, that people will be able to do much more bespoke things in a much more safe, secure, and enforceable environment than we see today. And as we look at the challenges of, you know, decaying infrastructure or infrastructure needs or trading environmental rights or trading commodities which are becoming more and more grade dependent. You know, you look at, I don't know if you went and tasted any of the coffee outside, but a coffee future for a Robusta versus some Arabica is becoming more and more complex. So I think customization is something which all this technology that you've talked about is bound to be offered on the exchange. And I think that we will see far more variety and customization provided through exchange traded products in the next decade than we see today. And I suspect that the most important forces driving that will be litigation, taxation, and regulation.
So, one thing is certain, that the next 5 years will definitely transform us much faster than the last 5 years. And if we are not able to keep pace with that change, we will increasingly get relegated. Having said that, a few diverse trends I do see. You know, while Hugh talked about the complex products and the customization, I strongly feel that public infrastructure like us will have a huge demand on us to provide simple mass products to the larger public, and that ties up with the point that Arunma made, that increasingly there will be pressure on markets to come with simple products that can be distributed mass scale to savers. Second, I also believe that the focus on risk and volatility and how we manage it can only be heightened over the coming years. While we have definitely coped and evolved very well in managing that over the last 5 years, there is only going to be an increasing focus and need for us as market infrastructure to be ahead of the curve in risk and volatility managing. And the focus on systemic risk events and our ability to manage this will come very much under scrutiny. And last but not the least, I think one has to see the entire play around how much banks will continue to be a very important part of the financing piece, or will this entire non-bank set of the sector really grow much faster? And if so, then how we will envelop or adopt them into the markets is going to be key for us to continue to be relevant and large.
Daniela, sum up.
I see there's a problem. Yeah, so I would like to highlight three key areas where I think exchanges will be very active in 10 years from now. So the first one is what we would call an all-in financing hub. So at the moment, exchanges are providing financing in a specific part of capital markets. I think going forward, the vision should be to be much broader in that, to offer peer-to-peer lending, to offer collaborative models with brokerages, with banks, to really have different business approaches to those means of financing. In some areas, you will use your traditional matching model and the related fees. In others, you will be more active in an advisory type role or in a brokerage type role. So that's one area I see which we find extremely interesting. The second one is around data and the availability of data and the ability to manage those front to back, where we see increasingly that exchanges are learning how to use the data of their clients even in post-trade. And I think the next stage will be to connect the dots between different asset classes, between different venues, and to collaborate with your peers around that, to really offer the industry more accessibility and enhance the quality of the financing and also essentially the capital markets overall. The third area is a futuristic one, which I really want to put out there, which will be a new channel to communicate with clients. So imagine Chitra is a trader, and she's using her iPhone to communicate to the market which stock she's gonna buy. So she's gonna say, I'm gonna buy this stock at this quantity tomorrow on this and that exchange. And then it's automatically executed instantaneously in a new space that is created in parallel. And in that space, the order then goes through all the way, but it will be like a second network that will not substitute what's already there, because we don't really believe that. It will rather be a test environment, but using all the nice technologies that we all use as gadgets today.
Thank you. So on this futuristic note, I just wanted to thank our panelists for this very stimulating an enlightening discussion around financial market infrastructure, the future, 2017 and beyond. I would just want you to give a big round of applause to our panelists. Thank you very much.